Welcome to the Take 92 podcast. My name is Sammy Warm Hands. I am your host. And today is a very special 75th episode. All right. This drops August 18th, which is 5 years to the day from the very first interview on this show in 2015. I am beyond thrilled to welcome one of my hardcore heroes, Lou Koller, from the greatest of all time, Sick of It All. Stay tuned. All right, man. Well, I really appreciate you taking the time to come on the show. I've been a little persistent trying to get you on, I know.
Oh, it's no problem. I just had to find the time, and now we have plenty of time. So.
Yeah. How are you guys doing with the lockdown? I know New York's been hit pretty bad, man.
Yeah, I mean, it's all right. It's, doing the whole staying self-quarantine and all that, only going out when necessary. Sometimes you go out. Like today, me and my family just went to the town next to ours to see what's going on. It was like a freaking ghost town, you know?
Yeah, it's a trip.
Which is weird because it's usually, hopping, especially in the summertime, you know?
Yeah, it's weird to see places you've seen packed a million times with, you know, looks like a zombie apocalypse shit with nobody out.
Yeah, exactly.
Have you guys in the band seen each other at all, or are you just... phone calls and Zoom.
Yeah, I haven't seen anybody. I haven't seen besides messages and phone calls and stuff like that. But we do have been recording, but it's just, we're just trying stuff out. So we did a bunch of old songs where it would be like Armand would video himself and record, and then he'd send it to Pete and Craig, and then they send it to me. And then we get our producer to check it out and mix it. So
that's pretty great, man. I like that a lot.
I like it too, but it came out fine, but I miss rehearsing with those guys, but that's the extras. That's like playing the songs is cool, but it's all the extras that goes, joking around and booking a 4-hour practice and only actually playing the set once and then talking for 3 hours.
Yeah. Seriously, man. I haven't seen my drummer in so long. Man, I've been recording demos here at the house and just emailing them to him. But, when you're trying to arrange a song, we're trying.
Yeah.
I was like, I got the bones of it, but we need to get like on Zoom and try to at least like map out parts before we put this shit to tape. Like, it's so weird.
Yeah. I mean, it's like the last few albums, the way we did it is because Pete lives in Florida.
Really?
And, Craig stays in upstate New York and Armine's in Westchester. And I'm in Jersey, we'd all write separately and send snippets, like you said. But then when we would be, all right, we're going to meet. Pete's coming up for 2 weeks. We're going to rehearse. And we'd go into the rehearsal room for 2 weeks and bang out, like, rearrange it and try different things. Stuff that, like, when you speak about it over the phone or whatever, it just doesn't really connect,
Well, yeah, that's the magic of it is it's one thing. I mean, yeah, like every record, I lay down ideas and I'll send them to him. But then... we just get together in the room, and that's where the magic happens, the collaboration, it's kind
of... Yeah, exactly. I can remember, like, even certain songs where we'd be playing them live, and all of a sudden Craig would be like, wait, instead of doubling, going back to the fast part here, let's cut it, play it at halftime at this point. It would just be like a little hook that you threw, and it just came up because we were playing it together in the room, it's something that he didn't come up with on his own, sitting in his bedroom.
Yeah, I mean, do you guys ever do that where you've had a song that you've been playing a while and then maybe even after it's recorded, you change it up for the show?
Oh, yeah, there's a couple. The first one that comes to mind is Maladjusted. The way that, because Craig just did Maladjusted with Roy from, he used to be in Nausea, the drummer, but he drums for Stone Sour and he drums with Corey Taylor. And I forget who else is on the track. Craig from Agnostic Front, also the guitar player.
Yeah, I watched that. It was so good.
They did a good cover of Maladjusted, but it was exactly like the album original. The live version, we switched. There's a break in there that we added just because Armine was like, it's too chaotic. Yeah. So we did that one. We did. Like, there's a couple of songs that we switched stuff up. It's funny. Sometimes we'll write a song a certain way. Record it, and then we go on tour, and then, like, at the middle of the tour, I'm going to go, like, what do you think about the way I'm playing such and such a song? And I'm like, "Oh, it's great." He goes, "I changed the drumming." I'm like, "You did? I didn't even notice."
You're like, "Man, I'm up here with the crowd. I didn't hear that shit."
Exactly. As long as the kick drum steady where it was.
That's what I tell the sound check engineers when I'm like, "Look, you can do whatever you want. Just make sure I hear the kick and the snare.
Exactly.
Otherwise, just have at it."
Yeah. And it's funny, as we got, you know, I guess bigger or whatever, and we used to do that too with monitors. Oh, just kick and snare all across the monitors and some and lead vocals. Now it's like, can you bring the floor tom up? And we get so spoiled, you know?
Yeah, right? Then you spend 20-minute sound checks and shit?
Yeah. Hey, 20 minutes is good. I mean, people love, like, when we do our sound checks, clubs or whoever, even other bands, are just like, "Wow, you guys get up, you play 2 songs, and you're done." We're like, "Yeah, we just get the levels we want, we're good." And then we sit there and laugh at the opening band who comes up and plays their whole complete set, like, 2 times.
Yes.
For their sound check.
Sound check is not practice.
Yeah, exactly. It's one thing if, like, they come in and specifically go, like, "Hey, we haven't played in a while. Is it all right if we sit up here and go over songs?" We're like, "Yeah, sure." It's funny when you get there and, yeah, we do our sound check and, like, "Yeah, these guys who need to do their sound check," and they play for 40 minutes and you're like, "Oh my God, stop for it."
I mean, I've done that on occasion where it's like, I also do a lot of hip hop. And so there have been times where it's like, "Oh, so-and-so is in town. He's going to be a, he's going to feature on this song. We haven't played this in person ever. So, hey, why don't you come up and do the sound check? Hey, do you mind if we run a whole track?" "Yeah, sure." Just bang it out once and basically wing it after that.
We've never done that, but I've been to asked to sing with other bands, and I'm always like, I always ask them, like, if I can come and do it at soundcheck. If we've never sang, I've done it with, you know, Rise Against have asked me several times, and each time's a different song. I don't like going up cold because I guess it's a nervous condition. The last time when they did the summer stage in New Jersey, I happened to be standing next to Brian Baker, and they come running off in between songs and go, like, "Hey, why don't you two guys join us? We're going to do a cover of Minor Threat." And I'm like, "Which song?" And they go, the song, Minor Threat."
Yeah.
And I went completely blank on the lyrics.
Oh,
I know
no.
That song forwards and backwards. But they want, I'm like, "Why didn't we rehearse this? Why didn't you?" You know? I can remember certain parts. So I told Tim, I said, "You sing everything. I'm going to jump in like we're the Beastie Boys. I'm going to sing what I remember."
Yeah, I'll hype you.
Yeah, exactly.
I've actually done that. I remember, shit, we were on tour last year, my band Dead Fucking Serious, and, you know, like, they wanted an extra song or something, and I just started playing the intro to Minor Threat, because, like, I just figured that our bass player would know it. I mean, like, we've played it before, but, like, everyone's played that song, and he's like, "Wait, what are you doing?" I'm like, "Ah, never mind, we tried."
That's happened to me also, where it's, like, I've gotten, like, when Refused did their first reunion, they asked me to come down to Brooklyn, and they did an Injustice System and Clobbering Time.
Oh, fuck yeah.
So I went for sound check with them, and the drummer has not seen us since, like, the early 90s when we played Sweden. And he was playing it at the original album speed, which was so slow. So it came off okay, and I go to him at the end of rehearsal, at the end of the sound check, I go, "Yeah, we kind of played a lot faster now." He goes, "Oh, okay." And then I came back for the show, and he walks up to me before they go on. He goes, "I watched a bunch of YouTube videos of you recently. I get it. We're going to play it a lot faster." And it was great.
And that dude fucking slays, too, with his, like, jazz style. That'd be great to hear for Sick of It All.
Yeah, he's cool. He was good.
Well, you mentioned, like, collaborations, features, whatever, and Clobbering Time. I mean, I did want to ask about the KRS-One thing that you guys did on Nonstop. I mean, that was pretty cool. How'd you link up with him?
Well, I mean, years ago when we first met up with him, that was through my older brother's girlfriend was working at a studio, and she came back one night to my house and says, "Oh, I got this." I go, "Who's in the studio?" And she goes, "There's a rapper, this guy, KRS-One." And I go, "Oh, Boogie Down Productions." And she goes, "You know Boogie Down Productions?" Because, you know, we're hardcore punk kids. And then she tells him this the next night, that my boyfriend's little brothers and all their punk friends love your music. And he was like, "Punk kids like my music?" And
that's awesome.
He said, "Bring them down." So we went down there, we met him, and we asked him to say the intro. And then fast forward years later to our, I think it was the 20th anniversary album, and we were doing stuff over. We said, we have to get KRS to do an update. And we called him up. We got in touch with him. We sent emails, all that. And he was down right away. And then when he did it, we go, okay, what do you want? You know, how much do you want for that? He goes, send me 3 XXL t-shirts. That's it. This guy's amazing. You know, this guy gets paid, you know, I don't know about guest spots, but I know for lectures, he gets paid really well. And he goes to lectures all over the world. You know, he's cool. He knows we're not a million-dollar making band. We're not, you know, barely making $1,000.
Oh, I'm sure his features cost a pretty penny.
Yeah, he was cool, man. He just, like, he knew. And it was funny because in between those two stories, I remember one time I was at a friend's house and his sister was watching some teen show on PBS, you know, like, you know, public broadcasting thing. They always had those teen shows. And they were interviewing KRS One and they asked him, what kind of stuff do you listen besides hip hop? And he goes, oh, I like some crazy stuff. I like this band called Sick of It All. And everybody in the room was like, oh my God.
That's awesome, man.
Yeah.
It's
good.
See, that shows my ignorance, though, because I got into you guys in the 90s on like Scratch the Surface shit. And so I'm showing my age when I say that I don't have the first record. I only have all the records with the current lineup.
Oh, that's all right. I mean, I love that first record. They're like, the songs are good, but the performances are not. You know, it's like we had 3 days to record, mix, and master that album.
That's insane. And
I think there's 22 songs altogether, and we did it. It was like a marathon of no sleep. You know, I mean, the band between us and our producer at the time, this guy Tom Swords, he did a lot of he did like the Cro-Mags, Age of Quarrel. He did Leeway's first 2 albums, I think. He was the guy to go to from New York.
Yeah.
He was in Rhode Island, actually. And, you know, he really fucking, he was a trooper, man. He was like, no, we're going to get this done. It was like a challenge to him.
I mean, did awesome. You have to track the whole thing live or what?
You know, I did scratch vocals and I don't think he even kept any of them.
Yeah.
He made me go back, like, they did all the music. And then the next day, I did all the vocals, and that same day, we did the backing vocals, and it was like a 24 hours of mixing.
Oh, my
and
God.
To be honest, some of those songs are like, you know, 30, 40 seconds or a minute, and they were like, okay, that's a set mix for these 5 songs. Let's hit it. You know, we tweak a little bit, but, you know, back then it was all analog, so it wasn't like Pro Tools now.
Well, yeah, and fucking 22 songs of hardcore vocals, even if they're short, that's a lot.
Yeah. But you see, that's a lot of it. That's why I don't like to listen to the album. I don't, you know, sound like I'm crack or anything, but some of it's delivered so monotone, I think just because of repetition or just fatigue or whatever.
Yeah.
That's another reason why on the 20th anniversary, we did a nonstop where we re-recorded a bunch of those songs.
Well, that's one of those things that I feel like every band who's been around long enough wishes they could do. Shit, half the time you drop a record and a year later after you've toured it a bunch, you're like, oh, I wish we would have done that one thing on the record, you know? It's like,
exactly.
You guys got to dive deep and redo, like, I mean, you had shit all the way up to Relentless on there.
Yeah. Relentless wasn't any different than it was on the album. We just tried to put it out so that, it was so weird when that album came out, Life on the Ropes.
Yeah.
Relentless was a huge hit. I remember our first show in New York after the album had been out for like a month. We opened with Relentless, and the place went absolutely crazy. And then you fast forward 2 years, we play Relentless, and not a soul moving in the crowd.
What the fuck?
Just like, we didn't understand, and it's like, was it a new generation, whatever? So that's why I asked for Relentless to be on that record to try and get people hyped about it again, but it really didn't work.
Oh, man, that surprises me. I saw you guys on that tour, and I remember that. I mean, that was... It's a good album, but like that song was the cut, you know, like that's the lead fucking fiery. That's the let go of that album, you know?
Yeah. That was a good fucking record.
All right. Let me dig into some of my notes here. Oh, I did want to shout out Erin Micklow because she had you on not the last time, but before that. And it kind of gave me the idea of like, oh man, when they got something coming up, I'm going to hit them up and and see if I could talk to Lou or Pete or somebody. And now you guys got this book coming out, so I had to reach out.
Yeah.
But, I mean, for me, I mean, you guys are the all-time, I mean, as far as hardcore is concerned, I mean, no breakups, no hiatus, no whack record. I mean, you got sick of it all is like every band member contributes. I've listened to some of your other interviews, and it's like, I know Armand writes a lot of lyrics, but I know kind of everybody contributes, and that's just so fucking rare, man. I mean, it's a beautiful thing.
It's been like that from the beginning. I think the first two records, it was 80% me and Pete, but Armand would come in and he would be like, no, don't do it like that. Do it like this. Because even back then, he would always say, you know, he wasn't an official member of the band. He was actually doing us a favor when we made the demo, when we made the first record, whatever. But he always contributed. And then Richie back then would always help come up with songs and riffs. And it's been like that since then. And I think especially the last few albums, everybody stepped up even more. The way on the last album, Pete came up with a lot of lyrics or partial lyrics. Me and Pete have co-written a bunch of songs on the last two albums. Craig came up with some really great songs, and I know him and Armand worked on lyrics on a couple of them, and some he just wrote all the lyrics, so it's been great.
Man, what you said about Armand, it made me think of, I think it was Brian Baker. It might have been Hedson, but I think it was Brian Baker who was like, helped out Bad Religion on like a song in the 80s, and then just didn't leave. You know, like he came in just, oh yeah, you want me to do a solo? Yeah, sure. And then it was just like, at some point they were like, oh, he is in the band at this point, isn't he?
That's great. Yeah, it was a weird time. Like Armand left to, well, before that he was in Rest in Pieces and Straight Ahead. We had this other drummer, this kid named Dave. He was a good guy, but he wasn't really, we did one show with him and he was done. He didn't want to play anymore. So we were going to do a demo. We asked Armand to rehearse with us for the demo. And he said, yeah, I'll rehearse it. Then we did the demo. Then he would go on tour with us when we got shows. And then we did the first album. I think by the time of the first album, he was a member, you know?
Well, and I know Craig was in AF and other bands and stuff before that, too.
Yeah. He was actually in Rest in Pieces also with Armand.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
But even on our first album, Craig came to the recording, that marathon recording, and he came up with like one line, and I forget which song. I think it was The Blood and the Sweat. He came up with a line for it. Howie, who writes the book with us, he helped me. In Justice System, I was stuck on a line, and he just said, I wanted to write something about being held by a leash. And he goes, how about short leash? And I go, oh, okay. That's
nice.
So, you know.
Yeah, that's awesome, man. How it just kind of happens,
good.
You know, like when the chemistry is real. It's like effortless, you know?
Yeah. It's true. It's a lot of people. It was funny. I went to the, when Killing Time had their 30-year anniversary, I remember Carl and Drago and me were hanging out talking, and he goes, I think Last Act of Defiance had just come out, and Drago goes, how the hell do you guys still make good albums after all these years? And I was like, I don't know, man. It's just what we love to do.
I mean, that's kind of my favorite thing about you guys is that, you know, in some ways, every record is better than the last, you know, and that's just such a rare thing, you know, especially once you guys linked up with Two Madsen, it really like changed the band, I feel like. I mean, as a fan from the outside, I feel like that was the genesis. It was almost like a second wind for you guys, because it's like,
yeah.
I mean, I know you jumped from label to label, producer to producer, and then once you hit with him and with Century, it was like, all right, this is what we fucking sound like, you know?
Exactly, yeah. I mean, Two got it, you know? I remember as he was... We were originally going to go with the guy Zeus because he did such a great job with Madball. But he was busy, and Tua had been befriended us because I went and I sang on a Haunted album, one of the Haunted albums. I went and I sang a song with them, and that's how I met Tua. And he started flying to all of our shows in Europe because he's based in Denmark.
Yeah.
And he would just show up at all these different festivals, getting our live vibe. And then when we finally decided, okay, let's give Tua a shot, he knew exactly what to do, and the Death to Tyrants was a result. And I was just like, when we heard it, we all looked at each other like, whoa, yeah, that's exactly what was missing.
That's pretty crazy that he did his homework in that way of like just trying to get the vibe right before you even walk in to talk about demos or anything.
Yeah,
I mean, it really shows.
he was a fan of ours for years, but he never thought to ask us to be the producer or whatever. He's known more for his mixes. He gets hired by, like, you know, Judas Priest and Ozzy or whoever, these big, big names to mix their albums. But he's produced a lot of stuff, but we were just so happy that he did his homework like that, and he didn't say, like, okay, I have this this mix I do for the band Hate Sphere, so I'm going to use it on Sick of It All. You know, it wouldn't work. He knew what we were like. He knew that we had, you know, metal roots, but we have roots in punk and oi too, so...
For me personally, Death to Tyrants, and I'm glad you brought it up because I was going to. That is my number one hardcore album, period.
Oh, that's great. Thank you.
That album is my, just as a musician, that is my pre-show ritual album. Like, if I'm playing like a hometown gig,
yeah,
that is in the van when I'm driving across town with the gear every single time. I mean, I've listened to that shit before, like, 100 shows, no joke. Yeah, it's just fuel to the fire, man.
Yeah, I mean, that's what we would do that with, like, the Bad Brains. We play that some nights. Some nights, of course, it'd be either Victim in Pain from Agnostic Front, yep, or you know, Age of Quarrel, just stuff like that to get you pumped and excited. You know?
Sometimes I put on Agnostic Front, Riot, that record.
Yeah, that's a good record, too.
But yeah, I mean, Death to Tyrants, that... And No Effects, what was it? Wolves in Wolves Clothing came out on the same day in 2006. And I remember going to the record store and picking them up. And I couldn't believe that, like, both of these bands that I listened to forever, that even predated me, had been doing it forever, were somehow better than before, you know, and just killing it, right? And I literally started my band, Dead Fucking Serious, like, a couple weeks after that, because I couldn't stop listening to those records, and I started writing. At first, it was a blend of this, like, super aggressive hardcore and this melodic skate punk shit, because that's just all I was listening to was those two albums, and
it
just stuck with me to this day. Of that's my go-to hype record.
That's awesome.
Oh man, so I mean, what was it about Century though? I mean, we talked about two, but I mean, you guys partnered with them for a long time.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's very strange. When we were leaving our first label, Relativity, you know, we did the first album, then we did Just Look Around, and they really didn't give a crap. They didn't push anything. And Just Look Around was a hit in Europe. It was licensed through Roadrunner there. But we were like, our contract's up. We don't want to... we're supposed to do 7 albums with them.
Oh, my God.
And... Yeah, well, we were kids. We thought we were going to do one record and break up.
You know, yeah.
We just do this for a living. So we wanted to get off the label. We went and met with the owner. We were like, you guys aren't doing anything for us. We're busting our ass all over the world. We're doing what they were banking on, this band Shotgun Messiah to be the next Guns N' Roses. And this is the thing. They gave us, for our first album and second album, we got $10,000 each to record, and which to us is like all the money in the world, but when you start paying for recording, it's not.
Yeah.
And meanwhile, they got Shotgun Messiah, a freaking house in L.A., a weekly allowance, and 4 rented cars for them to live the
rock and roll
L.A. lifestyle so they could write the next Appetite for Destruction. And it never happened.
Man, I listened to John Feldman on an interview, you know, from Goldfinger the other day,
yeah,
and he was talking about the same shit where, like, he got a deal for $10,000, and he had been working in a shoe store. And he's like, dude, to this day, they own half the rights to all of our classic shit, and I cannot get it back. He's like, but I just did not want to fucking sell shoes. I'm like, yeah, I get it. I mean, you're just starting out. You don't know any better.
I'm glad he's still around, and he's made money producing all that. It's a shame, because, I mean, look at even people like, what's that guy's name from Creedence Clearwater Revival? He didn't play all his hits for decades because he couldn't get the, he gave the rights away.
Yeah.
You know?
Or Jello.
You're a kid and you just want to play your music, you know?
Yeah.
But it was good. I mean, they went and they sold us. So back then, sorry to take off track, but back then.
No, I love it.
Century Media approached us and we were like a little wary because we knew the owners from the first time we went to Europe in 92. And they loved us. They loved Sick of It All. And they said they want us on their label, but we felt it was, we didn't know them. We only saw that they only had metal, etc.
Yeah.
So we ended up going with Fat Records for years, which was great for the first few albums, but then it just started to peter off, especially in Europe. I mean, America, they always tried their best with us, but we weren't a fat band, and they weren't able to push hardcore where it should have been pushed, which was the metal arena, you know?
It's so interesting. I mean, they had like a weird kind of hybrid of Sick of It All and Rise Against and Good Riddance, and it was, you know, and that a lot of that was like my gateway to that shit is from Comps, you know, and hearing Sick of It All on Short Music for Short People and shit like that, you know, or that song, I Believe, I think.
Yep.
Yeah. I mean, that was a cut too. Yeah. So, I mean, that was definitely happening at the time, but it's also only going to take you so far.
Yeah. But the real problem was the European office. They started out great for Fat, but then after a while, the two women who ran it just didn't give a crap anymore. My big example to that is we played this festival, and the headlines were Slayer, Ministry, Sick of It All, and Anthrax, who went on before us.
Damn.
And this is at, like, the height of Sick of It All in Germany. And it's in front of about 15 to 20,000 people, and we just fucking kill it. Like, we killed it so hard. We're walking off stage, and there's Tom Araya, and behind Tom Araya is all of Ministry. And Tom goes really loud. He goes, "How the fuck is Ministry going to follow that?" It was so much. Meanwhile, our label, Fat Records, doesn't have anybody there, no representative from the label, no press, nothing. We just played one of the best shows of our career, blowing away these metal heroes, and there was not one person there to grab us and go, "Hey, go talk to this magazine or this newspaper," or blah, blah, blah.
Oh, none, man.
So I get on the phone right away. Our tour manager was pissed. He was more pissed than us, and he was just our tour manager. He calls the girl from Fat Records in Germany, and I go, "Hey, you know what we just did?" And she goes, "Oh, I know you guys would do good." I go, "Well, why weren't you here? Nobody from the label was here." And she goes, "Oh, I don't like the heavy stuff. I like more melodic stuff." I go, "All right, thanks." And that's right then we knew we had to call Mike and be like, "Look, either you know you're not going to fire these ladies because they do good for your other bands, but we're out of here."
Yeah.
And our best advice we got when we were talking to all these different labels after that, we talked to Epitaph and whoever, even Victory Records, the hardcore label.
Oh, yeah.
And the best advice we got was go with a label where the owners love you. And Century Media came over and they were like, "We really still want to sign you guys." And we said, "Okay, cool." You know, at this point we were like, "Who gives a fuck?" And the best story we got from our friends, they became our friends, but people who worked at the label was like, we sent them the demos of Death to Tyrants and the opening track. We sent them the rough mix of it, actually. The president's sitting there, he puts it in, and the whole company's there, and he just halfway through it shuts the song off and he goes, "We got to put this fucking record out." He was so excited about it.
He didn't even get to the best part.
Yeah, exactly. He didn't even hear the end.
Oh, that's fucking great, man. Yeah, I mean, you got to have somebody who's really in your corner, you know, somebody who, I mean, it's cool to be the outlier. Even with a metal lineup, you're still the outlier, but you got to really have the faith.
To Mike's credit, he always loved Sick of It All.
Yeah.
Even to this day, when, you know, like, they had their, I don't know what anniversary it was for Fat Records, and Propagandi couldn't make it. He called us up, flew us from New York to San Francisco to play their anniversary party.
That's awesome.
Like, we were on the label for a long time, but we were off the label for about 3 or 4 years already, but he flew us over there to play the festival.
And then you guys went back to him. Was that because of you reconnecting there, or what?
The thing is, Century Media was the opposite of Fat in the fact that the European label killed it. They put us right back to being the level we were at, you know, pre-Fat in Europe.
Yeah.
But the American label was shit for us. All they would say is, "Yeah, it's a great record. Sick of It All is a good live band, but we don't know how to sell hardcore."
Ugh.
I don't know what that means.
Like, "Yeah, it's a great record. I'm going to just put it over here." Like, God damn it, man.
Exactly. What I learned from dealing with majors and even some indies is the A&R people will work like us and whoever else. And whatever sticks, whatever all of a sudden is it, that's the one they're like, "That's my idea. I championed that," you know? But they don't give a shit about you if you don't, like, sell a gold album, you know?
Yeah. I've heard stuff like that too, where, you know, as labels change hands and people come and go. It's like, oh, well, we were enthusiastically signed by so-and-so who's no longer here.
Exactly.
You know, and it's like, well, now you're the old news, that other guy's project. I'm not going to take ownership on this.
But yeah, the deal was when we talked to about the last album with Century Media, we were like, you have to step it up in America, blah, blah, blah. And our manager came with the idea, like, what if we do a joint release with Fat Records? Because they did very well for us in the States. And they agreed to it.
Yeah, that's smart, man. I was really happy when I saw that you guys were kind of joining forces, you know, Century, Fat, and Sick of It All. I thought that was awesome.
Yeah. But like I was saying, Mike's always championed us. He's been good. He's a good guy. We played festivals together. We did one of the punk and drublicks and all that. And he always comes up to us like, giving us advice on how to sing, how to be just a little more melodic. Like, we're trying, you know?
Man, but you're one of the only hardcore singers that I feel like can do a full-on scream with a melody, though.
Yeah, I try. That was my joke. I would say I try to scream in key.
Yeah, I totally get that from your stuff.
It's hard, man. It's hard trying to sound good and, you know, because I never learned, you know. I just went out and started screaming.
I've heard you talk a little bit, it might have been on that first interview with Aaron, too, about your vocal habits. I watched it feeling so much better about myself, because I'll go out there and feel like I'm killing the sets, but then after the show, everyone's hanging out and you got a long drive to the next town or whatever, and I'm like, okay, if I talk any fucking more, I'm
exactly.
I'm gone, you know. And I remember you saying something like that, and I was like, oh, thank God, it's not just me.
It's funny, because like when we take other bands on tour, the first few days, they're always like, what's up with Lou? Why is he not hanging out? Why is he, what's, you know, what's he don't like us? And they're like, nah, he's got to save his voice. And it's weird. I'll have friends that they can smoke, they can drink alcohol, they can drink freaking coffee. I love coffee, but when I'm on tour, I don't touch it because it fucks my voice up. I can only drink water 90% of the time on tour.
Yeah, man. I had a vocal coach forever ago, and they were telling me, they were like, do you drink? I'm like, no. And they said, well, do you drink soda or anything with like caffeine? I said, well, yeah. And they were like, I promise, just take a break from that and you will notice a benefit in your performance. And since then, I almost never have like caffeine of any kind, just for vocals, you know?
Exactly. Yeah. It's funny because, like, you know, we're touring the world and you're in Europe and you're in Italy or France, and we go to a cafe and they're all drinking coffee and it smells so good and looks like, I'm sitting there, yeah, I'll just have water.
Yeah, man. Or even just like you said about hanging out with your tour mates and stuff. I mean, I learned that the hard way just on day one, because I'm in Eugene, Oregon, and I remember our first show on one tour was in Reno. So the first day was just a drive day for like 8 or 9 hours. And we had the best time. And then we got there, and I'm like, oh, fuck. I already lost my voice. We haven't played a show yet.
See, that's the problem. It's too much fun in the band.
Exactly. Before I get to the book, I had to touch on a couple things real quick. First of all, one of my favorite shows that I ever got to play was opening for you guys. It was in, I think, 2001 on the Yours Truly record you were touring. It was just the wildest shit because, and I'm betting you remember this, but there was this like drunk punk in the crowd and he kept pushing to the front, hawking loogies on you. And I don't know if you know where I'm going with it. And the fucking dude, he keeps doing it, and you like, after, in between the songs, you're like, hey, man, like, we're the last band. Like, if you don't like it, you can go home. It's cool. Like, I'm not offended, but you got to stop doing that, you know. You played another song, and he's still doing it. And people are kind of pushing him away, trying to stop him, you know.
Yeah.
And you're like, hey, man, you really got to fucking take a walk, right? And then he does it again after another song. Oh, the second song, you were like, you know what? We're going to play a new one. And you played Hello Pricks. You know, it was like, no one's impressed with your lack of respect. Don't fuck it up for the rest, you know. And I was like, oh, that was perfect. Good segue, like keeping it positive. And then dude does it again in the third song. And you like crouch down on the front of the stage and they're pushing this dude up to the front. And do you remember what happened next?
I'm not sure. I don't know which show this is.
It's at the Wow Hall in Eugene, Oregon. And so they pushed the dude up to the front, and you got real quiet, and you crouched down, and you're like, are you going to hang out the whole night? You're going to be here after the show? And the dude's like just hammered out of his mind. He's like, why? What? And you put the mic in your left hand and gave him a right cross and said, so I kick your fucking ass after the show. And the whole crowd just swarms this dude, drags him out front, and throws him down the stairs. And,
oh, God.
Man, yeah, maybe you don't remember that shit, but that fucking...
I know. There's always somebody who's super dry, and I try to give him the benefit of the doubt.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dude, you gave him three strikes, man. He had three strikes. Well, and then after the show, he did come back. And I remember fucking, you know, the whole dance floor was cleared. The venue was empty. You know, we're just tearing down our equipment. And I hear all these people yelling at the back door to the club. And the dude is back, and he brought friends, right? And you guys, I think it's like Most Precious Blood and like
and
Blood for Blood, right? And so everybody's swarming to the back, and the poor, like, you know, it's a non-profit venue, and so the poor volunteers are back there trying to like calm shit down. And fucking Pete, I don't know where he got the fucking thing. He comes out of the green room with a giant monkey wrench. I'm like, where the fuck did you even? And I try. Like me, like little 16-year-old me, I stepped in front of him. I was like, dude, we don't need to take it there. And he's like, they're fucking with our van. And I just kindly stepped to the side. And he went out there and scared him off.
The thing of that story, the owner of the venue or the woman running it, she was really sweet when we came and all that. Then when I had hit the guy, she came running. I remember... It was either at the end of the set, whatever. I don't remember if we finished the set, but I just remember having to go into her office and she's screaming at me going, this is the kind of shit you bring. You guys will never play here again. I'm calling Stormy right now.
Oh, my God.
And I said, well, that piece of shit spit on me like six times. And she used the guy's name. I don't remember his name, but say his name's Eugene. She goes, well, Eugene was high. And I go, you know this fucking guy? And she goes, yeah. And you guys better get out of here because he's one of the street crust punks or gutter punks, and they're coming back. And I was like, fuck you, you know? I go, call Stormy right now. I'll call Stormy and tell her I don't ever want to play for your shit club again. All I remember is the woman was very mad at me because I punched her drug addict friend in the face for spitting on me all night.
Well, and honestly, I got a sick satisfaction out of it because around that same time, it was like maybe months before that, we had headlined a show there, my very first punk band in high school. That dude was there.
And he knew the owner.
Yeah, I guess. And so he fucking, maybe she guest listed him or something. But like,
that's what she did. Yeah.
I remember that fucking dude's face because he came up to me when we were loading up our shit after the show. He came up and I had no idea who this person is. I never met him in my life. And he licked my face. And like and so fast forward 6 months or whatever, and seeing that same dude get knocked out by my favorite hardcore singer was kind of satisfying.
But that's the thing, is we don't like to be like that. We never are like that.
No, you gave him every chance in the world.
There's stories in the book where you see where it's like how we're pushed into a situation and we're trying to be cool about it. The way that thing ended, what I remember is, yeah, we thought they were all going to mess with our van. We thought there was going to be an army of them because of what that woman said. They're coming back. It was like, I think, three guys and a little girl. One of the guys was huge. He goes, why'd you punch this guy in the face? And Armai was explaining it to him. Armai goes, he spit on our singer like six times. And then the little girl looks up and spits at Armai.
Oh, my God.
And then he looks at the guy and he goes, if that's your girlfriend, you're going to fucking pay for that. And right as he said that, it was the loading area was like on a porch or something or whatever. And all I remember is the guys from Blood for Blood reaching over the railing and dragging the three guys, flipping them over the railing from behind. And when it hit the ground, they were like, get the fuck out of here. And the guys got up and ran away. And the girl was standing there by herself. And Armai goes, get out of here. And she runs away.
Dude, that's amazing. Like that must have been like the second that Pete ran up behind.
Yeah, it was all...
Well, and I saw you guys like a year or two after that. It might have been the Life on the Ropes one at the Roseland in Portland. Mm-hmm. And I just caught you in passing, and I was like, yo, we played that fucked up show at the Wow Hall, and you just laughed, and you were like, man, I did not want to hit him, man.
I mean, look at me. I'm just a tall, skinny guy. I'm not a tough guy, but, you know, I'm a person. Don't sit there and spit on a person.
Yeah, know? Yeah, seriously.
It's funny.
All right, man, so we have to talk about the newest record, Wake the Sleeping Dragon, out now. That was in my top two records of that year, man. That fucking...
Thank you.
I mean, you guys always had the play on the dragon art, but it has this, like, King Kong, almost
hell
like
yeah,
vintage cartoony vibe that was just like, I think it's your best cover.
Oh, thanks.
Who did the artwork for that?
Ernie Parada, a friend of ours named Ernie Parada. He has a company called Hellgate Industries. He does tour posters for tons of bands. He did Last Act of Defiance. He
nice.
Did the... Based on True Story album cover, which was that was the last minute like thrown together one, but this one, him and me, we were in the studio doing the backups for the album, and Ernie was there, and I go, hey, we got to talk about the cover, and he goes, I always wanted to do a movie cover for you. I go, I always want to do a movie poster.
Yes.
And he goes, what about old horror movies like Frankenstein, this and that? And Armand walks over and he hears what we're saying. He goes, I always wanted to see the dragon on the Empire State Building. And I go,
dude,
King Kong, the 1930 whatever King Kong poster. And Ernie knew exactly what I was talking about.
Dude, I fucking love that, man. It just clicked. You're all in the fucking room.
Yeah. And then, you know, we came up with the concept of, like, you know, in the movie poster says starring so-and-so. So we put, like, you know, all of our band members and then guest vocals. And, you know, so it looked like an actual movie poster.
Yeah, so, yeah, I really like that vibe.
The poster came out great, and it's every time we write a record, I sit there, I'm nervous. I'm like, can we do it again? Is this going to be better than the last? Will people like it? And you have to stop that right away. You have to be like, do I like it?
Exactly.
You know? Because if we don't like it, we're not going to put it out. It doesn't matter if any. And when they started bringing in songs and shit, I was like, wow, this is really good. The funny thing was, Craig brought in Inner Vision. And the second they played it, like, Craig showed Pete riff, and then online it started coming with the drum parts. So the first run through, in my head, I'm like, this is the opening track.
Yeah.
And they were like, no. I'm like, yeah, you just wait. And when we finished the songs, you know, we recorded everything, I was like, listen to it. And they were like, yeah, that's the opening number. Because it's, Craig was sitting there going, like, I want to do, like, a Discharge song. You know, that's what he goes, in my head, I was thinking Discharge. But to me, it's like Sick of It All paying tribute to Discharge and the Bad Brains combined, you know? If you're a fan of our style or just, you know, old hardcore, and I don't know, I wouldn't say old, just hardcore.
Just classic hardcore, yeah.
When you say hardcore now, and I'm not putting these bands down, people think of, like, you know, Knocked Loose or something like that. And it's that's great. I think some of their stuff is good, but it's to me, it doesn't carry the way it has nothing to do with the hardcore I grew up in, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I stopped playing this shit for a while. I mean, DFS went on a break because it was like the only bands that ever came through were metalcore, being tough and starting fights, and it was just like, you know, this is not the vibe for me. And so, yeah, I'm all about the classic stuff, the positivity. And I mean, I just remember when you guys put out that leak for the opening track, the distorted vocals and, like, just the whole vibe of it, I was like, oh, my God, this is, like, re-energize.
Some of the
songs, I feel like they could have come off any Sick of It All record, you know? It's just that timeless sound.
Oh, thanks. But that's the thing to me. It was the energy of that track that set the tone for the album, you know? And that's I'm drawn more to bands that have high energy. And it doesn't mean they have to play at 100 miles an hour. They just got to have that groove or that power that, you know, energizes you, you know?
Yeah, you can feel when it's genuine, when it's passionate.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask just about a couple songs real quick on the record. The song Always With Us, can I ask, who is this in reference to?
We had two really good friends pass away as we were writing the album. And it's funny because Pete was sitting in there at home and he goes, I tried to write a song. He goes, I was listening to a lot of Coxbar and I tried to write a song like them, but it sounds like AC/DC. So... And he goes, he wanted to write it about our friend. We had a friend named Ludo who lived in Belgium. And he was just this cool guy. He had all these connections. He was every band that toured there knew him. He's connected to all these, he's the guy, he'd show up and his trunk would be filled with the most insane amounts of different Belgian beers you could ever want, you know, for the guys who drink beer, which Armin benefited from because he's the only guy in a band that drinks.
Yeah.
And he was just such a cool guy. And the last night we saw him, we had to move some. It was this weird thing with equipment that we had to leave in Belgium. He took it to his house or something. Then he loaded it all into his car and drove it to some festival where we came back to Belgium and unloaded. He did us this huge favor.
Man.
And it's weird because our relationship with him was all, you know, joking and making fun of each other constantly. But that night we all said goodbye to him. We were like, ah, thanks a lot. We all hugged him. It was funny. Instead of calling him shit face or something dumb, we really all hugged him goodbye. And then like a week later, he passed away of a heart attack.
Wow.
You know? And that's the first verse was about him. The second verse was about our good friend Dave, who sang for Vision, who died that same year.
Man.
And it was just, Pete came up with some, he had the lyrics, I'd say 70 or 80% done. And I just threw in like two or three lines. We went into the studio and I didn't know if I could do it. I think it came out good. And
I think
with our new producer on that album, Jerry Farley, him and me worked on vocals for like a month, like in the demo stages. I'd go to his house. He has a studio in his bedroom. But it was great. It was great. It really paid off.
Yeah.
And he would come up with good ideas, you know, like, oh, and this time when you do the pass on this line, just that word, go a little higher. Not where you're going to break up, but just go a little, and came out great.
Yeah, man, that song fucking, it hits home for sure.
It's weird. You know, we hoped our friends liked it, and people who knew them, there were grown men sending us emails who knew both those guys saying, like, I can't listen to this song without crying. Thank you. You know, he was such a good guy. You know, Dave was huge in the, not just the New York, New Jersey scene, but he was, you know, Vision was on Epitaph for a while, and he toured the world too.
Oh shit, yeah. Vision. They had that that song Closed Minded, right? Back in the day.
Yeah,
on...
that was their
Oh yeah, man, I haven't heard that name in ages.
Epitaph song, Closed Minded.
Yeah. A great song. I haven't heard that name in so long.
Yeah, yeah. I mean they had stopped playing, but they would get together once in a while and do a couple of shows. And Dave had come up from Florida for the holidays to be with his family, and unfortunately he passed away when he was up here.
Man.
Yeah. But yeah, you know, I think you gave him a fitting tribute.
Yeah, so, definitely. Last song I wanted to ask about was Work the System, I think is a very relevant track right now.
oh yeah.
Well, was there like a catalyst for that? Because I mean, obviously in 2020, it's even more relevant than 2018.
It was just about how everybody tries to work the system, from the poor man to the rich man, you know, but it's 90% of the time, it's the super rich that just benefit from no matter what you do, you know?
Yeah.
They're just showing the good and bad in everybody. Like you said, right now, it's like the government added that, what is it, that $600 bonus to your unemployment.
Yeah.
I have a friend who runs a landscaping company, and he had to let guys go at the beginning. And then a few months ago, he was like, hey, work's picked up again. I can hire you guys back. And they were like, fuck no, I'm making more money sitting at home. You know,
yeah, man.
So
I mean,
working the system, but they're ruining it for guys like me. I'm a musician, and I can't do what I love and get paid for it because I can't. I'm not allowed to tour, not allowed to play shows, and I need that money too.
Like, I was fucking trapped in a quote unquote essential retail environment. You know, I had friends that were making my salary and then some from the couch, safe and sound, while I got these people breathing on my face and shit. And I was not having it. Right now I work from home. I got a new job and I'm much happier about it. But yeah, I mean, it's crazy how, I mean, the people out there are at more risk and they're making less than the people in quarantine.
Yeah. I mean, that's why on the one hand, I understand why they want to stop giving the COVID bonus or whatever it's called.
Yeah.
But at the same time, they're giving a billion point something to the Catholic Church. Do they pay taxes? No, I fucking pay taxes.
Yeah,
you know?
Seriously.
You pay taxes. Do they give it to the church? You know?
Yeah, I mean, they got to be thinking long term, too, because that $600 is only going to take you so far.
Exactly, exactly.
Well, I feel like this is one of the best times to be a fan of punk rock and hardcore because the genres are at an age where we're getting documentaries and books and all this awesome behind the scenes shit. I mean, AF had both Roger's book, My Riot, and the Godfathers of Hardcore documentary. I was so excited when you and Pete got together and wrote this book. I got my pre-order in. I can't wait to read it. How did this project come to be? The blood and the sweat.
I think it was a year or 2 years ago. How he approached us. I remember he approached us first about doing it. And I was like, yeah, sure. You know, I just like blew it off. But Pete was really into it. And then we had a meeting with Howe, and he's like, I think it's going to be good. But in the meeting, the first thing me and Pete said, like, why can't it just be a Sick of It All book? Because it's an essential part. You know, we all grew up together, really.
Yeah.
And he goes, that'll be in the book. But he goes, to try a different angle than, oh, here's another book about a hardcore band. We want to talk about you two being brothers in a band and how it, for better or worse, what has happened. Yeah, and that's what we do, talk about it. Armin and Craig are in there. They've been interviewed. There's a lot of other people that we knew growing up and also, you know, bands that we've toured with. It's good. It's got some funny, I'd say it's more lighthearted than most hardcore books. It doesn't end every chapter with, and then I kicked his ass. You know?
Yeah. I mean, what is the format of the project? Because, I mean, it sounds like there's a lot of people contributing to it. I mean, are you guys sitting down and writing this stuff? Or is it mainly like you're doing these interviews and your co-writer is kind of helping you, you know, put it through that prism?
Yeah. He would try to instigate the conversations. Like, okay, in this era, what were you guys doing? When, you know, naming different albums or tour or whatever. So it's really just us talking about being together, growing up, and then starting the bands and all this stuff. And then he'd record it as he spoke. And then that's the process that was weird, is because then we have somebody else transcribe it. Then we have to sit there and read the transcription and be like, no, I said that. You know, sometimes it would say, Pete says this. And we'd be like, no, I said that. And then Pete would be like, yeah, Lou said that.
So they transcribe it, and then they give you a proof of that. And then from that, it's distilled into, like, the chapter or whatever.
Exactly, yeah.
That's a crazy process, man. That sounds super, I mean, to me it sounds fun, because I love all that behind the scenes shit, but I don't know. I mean, what was that process for you?
It was great. I mean, I think that's another reason how he got the idea. He would be hanging out and we'd all be backstage talking about, you know, even with him, like, hey, Howie, because he was essential and get assigned to our first label, In Effect Records. That was his label, Subsidy of Relativity.
Okay.
And we would be sitting backstage before a show and talk, and then be like, hey, Howie, remember that time at Relativity? We were coming to do a meeting, and we pull up, and then there's cops everywhere, and the whole warehouse just got robbed. That's, you know, that's an exclusive. That's not even in the book.
Yeah, I mean, where's the rest of the heist story?
They had their offices in Hollis, Queens. You know, where Run DMC was from.
Yeah.
It was like a middle-class neighborhood, but there was a high crime rate. And I guess somebody was watching the record company, and they knew that, oh, on this day of the month or week, the warehouse people get paid. And we would just walk through the loading bay to get into the warehouse. I guess they knew what time the checks were handed out or wherever they cashed their checks. And they just walked, two guys went in and robbed everybody at gunpoint.
Oh, my God.
We show up for a meeting, and they're like, I think you guys should go home.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah.
All right, man. Well, I fucking really appreciate you coming on. This was a real treat for me, and I'm
thanks for having me.
Yeah, man, I'm excited for the book. Everybody should go to the Sick of It All Insta, check out the pre-order info for Blood and the Sweat. You guys got a record store out in NYC that's the pushing the pre-order, right?
Yeah, Generation Records is doing it here. It's available, you know, of course, through Amazon and all that. But
yeah, I pre-order mine on Amazon. If you got an Amazon account, hit it up.
Yeah, if you go to like sickofitall.com or the Instagram and follow the links there, you know.
Oh, and then
you'll find it.
I saw you guys also raised a bunch of money for that auction for the Nomads. That was pretty cool too.
Yeah, that was good. We also did a limited edition shirt for Puerto Rico. And that did great. That raised almost, I think it was either almost $7,000 for,
wow,
for that. And it was given to a, I can't see right now, I'm drawing a blank, but it was given to this chef who went down there, and he would just cook dinner for the people for free. So we raised $7,000 for that too.
That's awesome, man. I love that you guys are doing that.
We try to do what we can do, you know?
Yeah.
Like everybody else, you know?
All right, that is our show. Thank you so much for listening. Huge shout out to Lou for taking the time. Sometimes I can't believe I get to do this show. It's really a privilege to talk with people who have inspired me for so long. Now, normally I would play you off with a song from this artist, but since he's putting out a book, I'm gonna show you a little extra clip from when we were talking off air. I asked him about one of my favorite features he did for Ensign, and we hit record again, so check this out. Let me kick it on again. 15 years with Ensign, bonus feature.
Yeah, I sang on that track. Years later, I sang on an H2O song.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
At Christmas time, the Bouncing Souls would always do the show, Home for the Holidays, and they always have their friends on. So at one show, it's Ensign, H2O, and the Bouncing Souls. And the Bouncing Souls call me up. They go, you coming? I go, yeah. They go, we're going to do Good Looking Out. We want you to sing it. So here I am going to show just to sing with the Bouncing Souls. And then Ensign goes on, and Tim goes, we're doing 15 years. You've never sung it with us live. Can you please do it in my hometown in New Jersey? And I'm like, as long as the Bouncing Souls aren't pissed. And they were like, no, go ahead. So I sing with him. And then Toby from H2O comes up to me, who we're going on next. And they were doing that song, What Happened to the Passion. And I sing on that. And he's all upset because he was a roadie with Tim for Sick of It All also.
Oh, yeah,
like,
yeah.
Oh, man, you're gonna come out and sing on our song, too? And I was like, oh, God. So by the time I go to sing with the Bouncing Souls, they're like, well, you've seen him twice. You might as well bring him out again. Here's Lou from Sick of It All.
Oh, man. That's great.